Chronological age is easy to measure, just length of time from when you were born. Biological age is harder to measure. And so a variety of different approaches have been taken to try to do this. The one that I think is most popular right now is the use of epigenetic clocks. So this is one of the things that we're measuring. And so the idea here is that there are chemical changes to DNA that regulate the expression of genes. We've known this for a long time. So this is a class of modifications called epigenetic modifications. And that just means it's not changing the code of the DNA, it's sort of on top of that. So it's not a genetic change, it's an epigenetic change. So these chemical modifications to DNA have been found to also change with age, with chronological age. And people have created these, what are called epigenetic clocks, that are very predictive of chronological age. And so when you do that, what you see is that across the population of people, or this has also been done in dogs, across the population of dogs, you can make a straight line for this epigenetic clock where chronological age is on the x-axis and epigenetic changes are on the y-axis. And so if you measure the epigenetic changes in a person, you can predict their chronological age. What you see when you do that is that there are individuals that don't fall on the straight line, that are either above it or below it. And the hypothesis is that those are people who are biologically aging at a different rate because they're not on the chronological age line. And so now people are trying to develop sort of more sophisticated tools to predict biological age from the epigenetic measurements.
When we think about health span, usually thinking about it in the term of lifespan helps first. So lifespan is usually the term people are most familiar with. So lifespan is the period of time from when you were born to when you die. So that's your lifespan. And health span is the period of your lifespan spent in good health, in which you have a good quality of life and you are free of chronic and or debilitating diseases. And so our goal is not only to improve lifespan and longevity overall, but even more so to focus on improving health span and lengthening the period of time that dogs and people hopefully experience healthy life.
If you think about the approach to medicine in, you know, 18th century, 19th century, 20th century, it has really always been from the perspective of individual diseases. So somebody gets sick, we diagnose what's wrong with them, we give it a name, they've got a disease, and then we try to either cure that disease or at least alleviate the symptoms of that disease. And if you talk to physicians about diseases, right, they will almost always give you advice on things you can do to reduce your risk of getting heart disease, cancer, diabetes. And it's almost always things like don't drink as much alcohol, eat a better diet, exercise more, all great advice, all important. But if you look at the actual impact of those sorts of lifestyle modifications, they change your risk of developing those diseases by somewhere between 1.5 to 3-fold, which is not insignificant. But if you look at the effect of aging 30 years, so going from 30 to 60, for all of those diseases, the change in risk is more like 100-fold or 1,000-fold for something like Alzheimer's disease. So orders of magnitude different than what physicians usually focus on. And so one of the interpretations of that observation, right, is that aging is really the greatest risk factor for all of these individual diseases that physicians think about, biomedical researchers think about. And if we can understand what aging is at a biological level, cellular, molecular, biochemical, we have the opportunity to actually target those changes to have an impact not just on one disease, but on all of these diseases that increase exponentially with age at the same time. And the impact that we can achieve from doing that is orders of magnitude greater than the impact we can achieve from exercising regularly or eating less or not drinking as much alcohol.
I think there's benefits all around. There's benefits to healthcare systems. You know, if we can keep people healthier and out of the hospital for a longer period of time, then we can help to minimize healthcare costs. It's beneficial to, you know, that person and that dog specifically to enjoy a happier, healthier, longer life. And it's beneficial, I think, to the world as a whole, just simply to be able to mitigate the effects of those chronic diseases and help people to live better lives.
In terms of interventions, at this point, we're really focused only on rapamycin. And in part, that's because rapamycin is the drug that has been shown to have the biggest and most reproducible effects on lifespan and health broadly in aging mice and in simpler organisms, but in particular in mice. So that's the intervention we're starting with in our clinical trials in dogs. And so we have carried out two small scale, shorter term clinical trials with rapamycin in pet dogs and seen some evidence for improved age-related heart function in the dogs that got rapamycin. And more importantly, no evidence of significant side effects. So tolerance for side effects in a clinical trial of healthy aging are very low. That's true in people, that's true in dogs. And so we've been fortunate that in our studies to date, we've really seen no evidence at the doses that we're testing that rapamycin has any real risk for the dogs. So now where we're at is embarking on what we call TRIAD, which is test of rapamycin in aging dogs. That is a double-blind, placebo-controlled, randomized clinical trial. We anticipate having up to 500 dogs into the clinic for that trial, of which our goal is to get 350 randomized and through the trial. Half will be placebo, half will be rapamycin treated. We are statistically powered to detect a 15% change in life expectancy. So lifespan is our primary endpoint. We have as secondary endpoints a variety of age-related functional measures, including heart function, activity, cognitive function, also looking at disease incidence. So how frequently do the dogs get cancer, kidney disease, other diseases of aging that are common in dogs. And so that study is designed as a three-year trial. So the dogs will be observed for 3 years. And then at the end of the 3 years, we will be able to assess whether or not rapamycin significantly increased lifespan or had an impact on any of the functional or disease measures that we're studying. I really view this as, in many ways, a foundational clinical trial, right? So this is really the first time anybody has ever tried to do a clinical trial for aging in any organism.
Legumes has no anxiety about the future and no regrets about the past, right? And it reminds us, you know, and being in the Dog Aging Project has made us think about our dog that way. And how much exercise we give our dog informs how much exercise we get. We call it mommy takes a walk, doggy takes a walk. So I think that doing and being involved in the Dog Aging Project makes us think about our dog's care differently.
So the Dog Aging Project is still actively recruiting dogs and their owners to be a part of our amazing project. And there is no limit on the dog that can be nominated for our project. So we take all ages, breeds, size, gender, intact dogs, neutered dogs, all of the above. And so if they are a canine, they are eligible to be nominated for the project. And you're more than welcome to reach out to us through our website, dogagingproject.org, or peruse our frequently asked questions tab on the website to answer any questions you have.